Hey everyone, Seb here, welcome back. So today's episode of Kotlin Standard Library Safari is going to be a bit different. Generally in this show, I want to highlight things in the Kotlin Standard Library that you're going to find interesting and useful. But while I was writing the script for a few episodes, I actually realized something critical. What's really at the center of all of this is exploration, finding out stuff about the APIs that you might not have known before. So, instead of going straight into the next topic and look at the next set of standard library APIs, we're going to take a bit of a different route today. Instead, I want to give you some handy tools to help you explore things on your own. First and foremost, the standard library, but in fact, just Kotlin code in general. It makes sense to me to address this sooner rather than later, you know, so that while you're waiting on the next episode of the show, you're already well equipped to discover some of the goodies in the code you're working with on your own. The beautiful thing about working with Kotlin is that with IntelliJ IDEA and Android Studio, we have some powerful companions at our side that help us in every step of the development process. So let me share with all of you how I read and try to understand Kotlin code that I encounter and modify. I'm working with IntelliJ IDEA here, but the same thing should apply for Android Studio just as well. And when I talk about keyboard shortcuts, I'm going to mention the macOS key bindings because that's the operating system I happen to use, but you're going to see Windows and Linux key binds on the screen as well. Now, whenever you see me put code on the screen, you might have noticed that there are these gray little bubbles wherever variable names or types appear. These are called inlay hints, and honestly, I don't want to read code without them anymore. We can enable those in the preferences under Editor, Inlay Hints, Kotlin. I personally can't get enough of them, so I have all of them enabled, but if you're feeling overwhelmed with the amount of information they put on the screen, you have some fine-grained control here. There are a number of situations where I especially appreciate inlay hints. Now, for example, when I'm chaining a bunch of operations, they give me a quick sanity check whether I'm creating the correct type in the end. They're also awesome whenever you encounter lambdas, especially lambdas with receivers, because they give you information about the variables which are implicitly in scope and which receivers your lambda actually provides. Especially if we are working in a project that makes heavy use of Kotlin's DSL functionality, those hints can kind of help demystify some of these APIs and just generally help gain even more insights into how the code works. Oh, and as a little hint, if we are using the Gradle Kotlin DSL, so if our build file ends in .kts, these inlay hints also work here. I have to admit, I tried to actively avoid touching Gradle for a long time myself, but I'd say that the Kotlin Gradle DSL, together with these inlay hints, are one of those features that have helped me understand how the DSL for Gradle works, what functions are in scope, and so on. So yeah, that was my little ad for the inlay hints feature. If you try it yourself, maybe you'll fall in love with it just like I did. Now I actually want to return to something a bit more basic, but that I'm still seeing people miss out on. Code completion is definitely a common way in IntelliJ IDEA or Android Studio to discover an API. We all know the drill. We put a dot behind a symbol and we get some suggestions of what we might want to call here. But what about situations where this doesn't pop up naturally? Those exist as well. For example, when I'm inside a lambda, such as this builder function. Now, first of all, notice how the inlay hint actually gives me this nice information that I have an implicit this in the scope here. And of course, I could use this information to type this and then a dot. But that completion isn't really the most elegant way. After all, I don't need to write this here, and I probably don't want to keep the this in the resulting code either. That's like the whole point of it being implicit. Well, how do we get completion then? The answer is real simple. We can actually just press Control Space to manually invoke completion based on our current scope. And this works practically everywhere. So in the example of this builder block, it shows us all the functions we can access in this scope. And if we're returning to an unfinished statement, we can also use Control Space here. Super versatile, I use it every day. In fact, if I actually check my productivity guide in IntelliJ IDEA, it says here that I invoked basic code completion over 2,000 times over the last 4 months or so. And I'm not writing code full time, so yeah, you get the idea. All right, let's say completion found as a function that looks promising judging by its name. When you first type out this function with parentheses, IDEA gives us a little hint bubble that tells us the parameters that this function accepts. But that pop-up actually only appears the first time we put down the function. But because we're dealing with an API that we might just be exploring, we might not immediately fill in all the parameters. We go back and forth in our code, and when we return to our function, we would really appreciate a quick reminder of the parameters that it accepts. Well, this once again is a simple trick. If we press Command P, we can magically summon that pop-up again that we've seen before. And if we look at a statement that has been written previously, we can see that even here it might make sense to hit Command P again, because the pop-up also shows things like default parameters and overloads. This once again helps us discover new functionality while typing out our own code. In this example, maybe we find ourselves in a situation where we want to compare two strings, but weren't sure if or how the function accepts an extra parameter to ignore the upper and lower casing of the text. Oh, and we actually talked about ignore case and friends in the previous episode of Kotlin Standard Library Safari. So check that one out as well if you haven't yet. And while we're already inspecting the parameters of a function, we can actually go one step further. We can pop open a quick documentation. If we hit F1, IntelliJ IDEA is going to show us a little text blurb explaining what a method is supposed to do. And here's a nifty little extra trick. We can actually pin this window to the side of the IDE, and we can click the little cogwheel that says auto update from source. And now if I click around and code, I always get up-to-date information on the side of my IDE about the function that I currently use. And now that I've already brought up documentation, it's also a great moment to plug the official kotlinlang.org website and the docs you can find there. Because really, let's not kid ourselves here, what I'm doing isn't foundational research. The Kotlin Standard Library is well documented. And without a doubt, if you go to the docs on kotlinlang.org and take some time to browse through some subjects or pages you haven't read beforehand, you might find yourself learning about a concept or a language construct that will come in handy the next time you're creating new code with Kotlin, or refactoring some code you wrote a few months back. But enough about that. You know the docs exist. I know that you know the docs exist. Back to the IDE. And let's talk a little bit more about navigating code. Now, if you're only taking one shortcut away from this, let it be Command Click, or as known by its formal title, go to declaration or usages. As that name might suggest, it's actually a two-way shortcut. When we click on the usage of a symbol, so a variable, a place where we're constructing a new object, invoking a function, or where we're implementing an interface, this shortcut is going to send us straight to the definition of what we just clicked. And vice versa, when we click on a symbol declaration, so a place where we're declaring a variable, an interface, a class, or a function, this is going to give us a list of all the places in our project where that symbol is being used. In an average Kotlin program, a lot of things are command clickable. And command click is an easy way to reveal interesting information about your own code and the code you depend on. You can really go wild with it. For symbols that we define ourselves, like variables, this is just a really neat way to navigate our own code base. But of course, we can also click into library functions, both from the standard library or from any third-party library that we have added to our project. I find stepping into a library useful for a bunch of reasons. We can look at the code we're calling, learn something from its implementation and its structure, and we can kind of immerse ourselves even deeper and kind of swing from implementation to implementation and see how everything is built up. Anyway, looking at where we've ended up, as is convention with both Kotlin and Java files, once again, we have the docs right next to the implementation. IntelliJ IDEA and Android Studio actually have this nifty little feature called rendered API docs, which makes it a bit more comfortable to read the docs which are included with the code. I personally like it because it also gives us an even stronger contrast of what is docs and what is code. Now let's say we've ended up navigating to a file that we find particularly interesting. You know, one where there's a lot of implementations, a lot of juicy code to look at. We can of course scroll up and down, take a look at some symbols, read about them and so on. But IDEA once again can help us with a more structured browsing approach, which might help us discover interesting parts of the file quicker. There's the structure tool window, which we can find via view tool windows structure. And we can use this as another navigation helper, you know, to give us an overview of everything that's in the file, conveniently located right next to the actual source code. And last but not least, if you just can't find what you're looking for by navigating around this way, you can always go back to the good old search function. We can reach that with find in files, reachable via Command Shift F. And there's a little trick. By default, this function actually only searches our own code, not the code of our dependencies. But if we hit scope and select projects and libraries, now we're also searching in those files as well. And there's also the so-called structural search. Which is a bit of a specialized tool when it comes to scouting out code. It allows us to find constructs matching a specific schema. For example, finding functions that have exactly one parameter or that return a string. You might not use this one as often, but it's always good to have heard about the fact that it exists, because you never know when that knowledge might come in handy. And then you can look back into the topic a little bit more deeply. All right, as I said, a little bit of a different episode today. I promise you, next time we're back with tackling more topics related directly to the Kotlin Standard Library. Hope you enjoyed this one nonetheless, learned something new. If you have some must-have settings, shortcuts, or whatever, feel free to share them in the comments. And you know the drill, to stay up to date with all things Kotlin, subscribe button, notification bell, yada yada. Anyway, next time you touch Kotlin code, try using some of the new things you've learned today. And maybe try to burn these three shortcuts into your memory and use them rigorously. We had command click for jumping around in your code, finding declarations and usage sites. We had command p for showing the nifty little parameter hint bubble. And we had control space for completion anywhere and anytime. Of course, there are tons of other productivity shortcuts in your Kotlin IDE. If you're interested in more of them, check out the linked video which covers the top 15 IntelliJ IDEA shortcuts. Or grab yourself a virtual version of the IDEA keymap, which has an overview of the most used shortcuts using the keymap of your choice. Link in the description for that one. And just go ahead and try integrating your new knowledge when you work with Kotlin code the next time. In fact, you can go ahead and do that right now, because I'm signing off. And I hope that you will go and explore some more Kotlin. Take care.